まあね、川がある排水溝ですね。それで、所有はね、ほとんど水がないから、ところが、津波をね、一般目はこれだった。二番目、食べるくらいだったり、登り始めた。それからずーっと引かない、そのまんま。ね。もう私たちも、先代からすごい人にもうないの。私の誕生日も、70年なんで、そういうことあるんです。70年とか。
The locals here fear the receding water will expose bodies swept up from the coast. Traveling north, McRae reaches Okanato. At first, the town seems untouched. Closer to shore, it is a different story.
As if Okanato didn't have enough problems, the scientists reckon that this whole area, this region, has subsided well over a meter, and in the next couple of days, the region is also expecting the highest tides of the year.
Is some 500 meters down there, and yet up here we have this. It's a remarkable sight. I understand it's a huge tug that has been brought all the way up here by the tsunami. And what's remarkable about it, and what's even more remarkable about it, is that what it says about the size of the tsunami. Because the Japan Meteorological Center just produced provisional estimates saying that the tsunami that hit this region was about 3.5 meters high.Now we're 7-8 meters above sea level here, and even given the surge, the fact that it could bring that all the way up here does suggest that the tsunami here was a lot higher than 3.5 meters.
Boats, trucks, and cars are dumped on top of buildings much higher than the recorded height of the wave. That happens because as the water is pushing through the city areas like streets of towns and villages.Is being effectively funneled. The water goes somewhere, and so it goes up because it's squeezed and funneled and pushes material, such as cars, onto roofs, sometimes as high as 50 feet. So in areas, the impact of this will be even greater, particularly at narrow streets.
Once the wave starts to pick up part of the town, the warehouses along the dock, the debris and all that, then it becomes more like a glacier.It's a moving wall of debris, and the more mass it has, the more power it has as it comes in. It doesn't really look like water, but it looks like the entire town is flowing, and it is. So all the mass of all the buildings, cars, and refrigerators, and everything that's in that wall, it's essentially a debris glacier at that point, and it just keeps coming in.
This is Manami Sanriku.A town that has been virtually wiped off the map. 95% of the buildings destroyed. Over 10,000 people, half the population, missing.
This place symbolizes the tragedy more than anywhere. An entire town wiped out by the force of nature.
It's almost difficult to imagine one's thoughts.
buildings, cars and things, you end up with sort of really quite horrific mass moving through towns, villages, across fields, causing complete destruction.
I mean, it would be bad enough if it was on the water, but because it's full of cars, you can't swim against it or flow with it or do anything. It's just like in front of a bulldozer of moving the entire town.
It's funny that when you hear that sound of an ambulance, it kind of gives you hope that they might have found somebody alive. Although that must be happening here and here, and between anyone who did survive and the trap, is almost certainly died of hypothermia by now.
At the town of Rikuzen Takata, 25 miles up the coast, rescue workers hunt for survivors and discover the dead.
And they find a body in the face with a large stick in the dirt, right in front of the surface of the recovery place. There we do some of the sad stuff. In fact, they're not just collecting bodies, they're also collecting personal mementos as well. They're fine. Quite good.
Within days, scientists gather more data from Japan's earthquake and tsunami than from any other disaster in history. Over Tokyo, Professor Roger Billum returns from his aerial survey. The city's vulnerability is clear.
There are 30 million people within about 2 meters of sea level, and a tsunami here, of course, would be absolutely devastating.
Suddenly, there is a problem.
We had a big earthquake just now, so...
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We just learned from the ground that there was an earthquake that damaged the heliport. They're checking for damage right now. We don't know how big the earthquake was, but it was obviously a nearby aftershock.
A massive aftershock hit Tokyo, magnitude 6.2. In the week that follows the main quake, there are over 500 aftershocks. This is the actual data from seismometers around Japan. The larger the circle, the bigger the aftershock. Finally, Billum's helicopter receives the all clear to land. The helipad is damaged.
I noticed that the tarmac here, which should be beautifully dark everywhere, in fact, stained white, as you can see, that sand has come out of the crack, and there's another one there, another one there. We're very close to the shoreline, and the lurching motion of the ground during the earthquake caused the subsurface liquefied sand belching out on the top.
Here there is evidence of liquefaction, the strange phenomenon filmed earlier.
And over here is an old volcano. Old, it's about 3 days old. You can see how the mud is pouring out the top there. So we're 200 miles from the epicenter here, and here's a crack in the heliport landing area. It continues all the way along here. You can actually see down about 3 feet in places. Flip this to here, this goes over, this will be an offset in this trim around the tarmac.
As the Earth's crust shattered during the main quake, new stresses spread along the fault. Relieve the pressure in one place, and it builds up somewhere else, triggering aftershocks.
what you're seeing here is how those aftershocks happened over a period of about a week after the main shock. And that orange region, delineated by those orange dots, essentially gives you a feeling for the area of the fault along the plate boundary that ruptured in this event.
Every aftershock takes its toll on an already frightened population.